all that chitter chatter back there. Oh, good job. See, I'm just going to say that, and it just works. What a beautiful day. Sun shining, and here we are all together. No snow for a change. It's good to see y'all. All those smiling faces out there. All right, what are we doing? I'm not sure. I don't have anything here. Oh, there it is. I'm not going to go through the whole thing. I'll just let you know that we have the list up on the bulletin board beside the exit door at the front, and we have a list downstairs as well. So, but mainly it's Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. There's always something going on here, and during the week there are other days too. We're part of those other programs. That's it, pretty much, except for. Oh, I'm getting signals now. There's a men's fellowship time coming up where we're going to get together and play games. And Danny's running that. So, Danny, come on up and tell us all about it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, next Saturday, I'm actually kind of nervous. I'm going to. So we're going to do a men's dinner next Saturday at 5 o'clock. So we're hoping that all you men are going to show up, and men are going to start from the ages of 10 and up, okay? We're hoping that the men will bring like a side, like a salad or like baked beans or whatever you guys want, right? We're going to take care of the chicken wings and the pulled pork sandwiches, and we're going to have a good time. Get to know one another, and that's it. I'm really nervous.
Good job, everybody. I think I know what Lise was telling me earlier. She was doing the YMCA thing. Now, annual general meeting is coming up on the 22nd, I believe it is.
Oh, it's up here.
Yes, February 22nd, 7 p.m. We do it once a year. And so come on out, because each department will talk about how the year went, what we did, and upcoming things that are coming up, and any business with the church, and how's it been going. And yeah, if you want all that stuff, come to that. They got a fancy name for it, AGM, Annual General Meeting. Okay. The ladies got together and made their cards. Melody, do you want to mention anything about that?
Sure. Just want to thank everybody for all of their help. We did 200 cards in just a little over an hour, and everybody that stayed behind helped clean up. Honestly, that was just like a godsend for Matt and I. Like, it was just so great. And so thank you very much. I will be going tomorrow morning to deliver the cards, and I'm sure they'll be well appreciated. Thank you.
I have pretty much my whole family over at Cedarvale Lodge, so I know they will appreciate that. Some of them don't see anybody for the longest time, and so yeah, thank you ladies for taking the time to do that. I think that's pretty much it. Like I say, oh, anybody new with us today? I want to make sure, oh, right there. Did you get a bag?
Yes.
Perfect.
Yep.
In the bag, there's a card. If you fill it out, you give it to the Jeff, the guy holding the blue bowl over there, or yeah. He's right there by the door, and he'll have a Tim's card for you, so you can get a delicious coffee on us.
Thank you.
Okay, no problem. That's it. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this beautiful day and this time we have together to sing and praise your name, be in everything that goes on, including the kids downstairs as they're learning. Just bless them as they all learn together. Be with us up here as we open the Bible and learn from you. Just give us hearts and minds to receive what you have for us this day. We ask this all in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
Let's all stand together. The praise team this morning, we read from John 20 in our devotions, and I'd like to share it with all of you. John 20, starting at verse 24 to 31. This is after the resurrection. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." That's us. Isn't that awesome? Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together. We have so much to celebrate this morning. We're so excited to get together, aren't we? I know I am. We need this time together to focus all our attention on Jesus and remember all that he has done for us. So let's just give him all our best singing this morning, our best praise, because he deserves it all. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. There's joy in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
My God, he holds the baby to me.
Sing it out.
There's joy.
God, that it is your working that reveals who you are to us. And if we really want to know the truth, if we really want to know you, you will show us, Lord God. And so we invite you this morning, anyone who is struggling with doubt as Thomas did, would you speak to each heart this morning? Reveal yourself, Lord God. We want to know you. We want to know you more, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, oh God. Goodness and grace, your love on us.
I'm We say, without you, there's no meaning. Without you, there's no meaning. And you got to take a look at your life. You got to come to that place where you take a look and you say, what is the meaning of life? Maybe you saw the movie by Monty Python, but that's not going to help you. What is the meaning of life? Is it meaningful without God? I found before God was in my life that I work, I sleep, I eat, and I party all the time. And what was the meaning to it? Yeah, I had children. I loved my children. They were lots of fun. But when the children grow up and get married and they're gone, you don't have them anymore. Now what's the meaning? What's the purpose? Well, then you get grandchildren. Oh, that's good. That's fun. I've enjoyed them too. But then they get old. And they don't call anymore. And then you come back to that question. What is the purpose? What is the meaning? What am I doing all this for? It's no wonder. I'm not surprised. I'm not shocked. When so many people take their lives. Mm. This is, you want to talk about pandemic. Mm-hmm. The suicide, it's such a high rate of suicide. Why? Well, because there's no meaning without God. And now we've removed God from our society. There was a time when people had a choice. Now, you talk to kids in the high school, say, do you know who Jesus is? Well, I hear his name all the time, but I'm not really sure. Without God, there is no purpose. There's no meaning. But when you have God in your life, now you have meaning. You have purpose and you have hope. And you can pass that on to your children and your grandchildren. And you can pass that on to other people around you. Loving your neighbors. That's a good song. Have we sung that before? Yeah, I thought so. I don't know. They all sound the same. I love them all. Is it hot in here?
Yes.
It's very
hot. I thought it was just me. Turn I thought I was fans. Having a hot flash. Can someone, is Colin here?
There. Fans are on.
Yeah, that's not, we need the air conditioning on. No. So, pop open them windows.
You're just on fire.
I'm on fire? Woo! Wow. Good morning. Welcome to Hope for Today Fellowship.
Good morning.
That sounds official, eh? Yeah. Wow, good to see you all here. I thought no one was going to be here because it's the toilet bowl today, right? the sugar bowl. The Super Bowl. Super Bowl. I'm a big sports guy. That's great. Super Bowl today. Listen, Danny's still here. Oh, So you said that the men's thing is at 5 o'clock. The announcement said 6 o'clock. And I wrote on the calendar 7 o'clock. So can you just clarify that one there?
You're the boss.
No. Never.
All right.
Go ahead.
6 o'clock's good.
Yeah.
6 o'clock's good. There you go. So is it dinner then?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I thought it was just like snacks. Let's have dinner at home and then come and have snack. We'll eat twice. Oh, I know. You like that, eh? Okay. 6 o'clock. Pulled pork.
Yeah.
Chicken wings.
Chicken wings. And it's done like by a chef. This is not Mickey Mouse stuff like the women have, those muffins. Okay, I'm feeling bad because I wasn't invited to the ladies' thing. And we're not doing Valentine cards, right? Oh, yeah, okay, good. Okay. This is good. Okay. And today's Trisha's birthday. Yay! There we go. Yeah, 42. 31? Oh, you're not going to tell us?
Oh,
37. 37? Yeah, it was close.
You're still a baby.
37. Yeah, just a child, eh?
Right?
Half my age. Well, not really. And Malachi's asleep. That's good to see. Yeah, okay, great. How's William doing? Is William here? Is he asleep? He's never asleep till he's done screaming through my sermon, right? I owe William an apology because last week I said something about William screaming while I was preaching, and it wasn't William. Turns out it was Malachi. I'm getting my babies confused. That's great. That didn't embarrass anyone, right? Was Warren embarrassed? He didn't even hear me. So, oh man, we better pray. We better pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day. What a lovely sunshine we have. And Father, thank you for your goodness in our life. Thank you for all the things that happened yesterday, the way the women got together and they loved to chat and stuff and they had a great time. And that's wonderful. Father, we thank you for everything. We sing these songs. We sing these songs. Sometimes we sing them. We're just feigning praise. We're not meaning what we're saying. Oh, but God, you've had a hold of us since birth. You knit us together in our mother's womb. You've been chasing us since birth. You're running after us, running after us, running after us. It's not us that found you. You found us.
Yes.
And we're so grateful. We're so grateful. Mighty God, we do exalt you. We lift you up. We put you before everything else in our life. We exalt you. You are King. You are God. You are our Lord. We thank you. Thank you for everybody that's here this morning. Lord, I know there's so many problems. We're all going through something. That's the way this world is. Because of sin, there's problems. There's trials. But God, I'm so glad that we don't have to go through these alone. We go through them with you. You hold our hand and you help us through those fires. We're so grateful to you. How our heart breaks for those in our community who are going through trials and they're going through them all alone. All alone. It seems like when a trouble comes in our life, everybody disappears. We've got to do it alone. But we have Jesus Christ. And we're so grateful. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness. Lord, as we look into your word this morning, I pray that your Holy Spirit would speak to us. Come, Holy Spirit, speak to us, stir up our hearts, challenge us with your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Oh, beautiful. Oh, I forgot to pray for Derek's mother's sister. No, Derek's mother's sister died, right? How old is your mother?
Mom's 81 and your sister was 92.
92. God, take me before then, please.
Yeah.
Smokes. So, but she's in heaven, right?
Yeah, this morning.
Oh, so it was great rejoicing. Yeah, that's good. Wow. You know, people die. People die all around us. They're dying all the time. And I tell you, the difference, we were at a funeral yesterday, and it was It was a very nice funeral. It was Lloyd's brother, Lloyd Curl. You all know Lloyd Curl, garbologist. And so Lloyd's brother died, and they had the funeral at Keswick Christian Church, and very nicely done. And the wife, I went to hug the wife, and she said, "Oh, don't make a big deal. He's gone to heaven." She was a little rough around me. So anyway, it was wonderful. It was wonderful because when someone dies and they know Jesus Christ, they've gone to a better life. They're getting a reward. It's not like, oh, well, at least they have heaven. No. To live is Christ, but to die is gain. Amen. It's a good thing. And so we rejoice with these people who have gone on to see Jesus. But when someone dies without Jesus, that's sorrowful. That's when we need to mourn with those who mourn. A terrible thing. It's a sad thing. Oh. Anyway, we're reading from Genesis this morning. I'm not even going to tell you where because we're not going to put it up yet. The flood has just ended. Remember? The kid really loves me, I'm telling you. Here he goes again, Mom! We got to work on that nursery so that Mama trusts the nursery people. Oh. Where was I, Laura? Oh, yeah, so the flood has just happened. We saw God's judgment poured out upon all mankind. It's a global flood, and all mankind has been judged. They all rejected God except for eight people, and eight people were saved in that floating vessel, and along with two of every unclean animal and seven of every clean animal. And so these people, the boat has landed. The vessel landed on the mountains of Ararat. And the people came out of the boat when the water subsided. That's not a hard word. And then the first thing that Noah does is he builds an altar to God. And he does a sacrifice. He thanks God. He thanks God for what's just happened. This judgment, you know, we can look at this and say, well, God is hateful. And no, God is perfect and just. And when he says to us that sin will result in death, when he says that, he has to be faithful to his word. If he's not faithful, if he says, well, I've changed my mind, I'm not going to kill anybody for sinning, for disobeying me, I'm not going to do that, then God is not righteous and just. Now we've got a God, you can have a God who's all-powerful and all-loving, but if he's not just, if he's not fair, if he's not righteous, then we have a huge problem. We have a God that can actually be evil. I don't mean this by the evil part, but the other part. It's like a mother. That's why I said it. My wife's here. So, no, but a mother can love her kid so much and want that kid to know so much that she loves her, that child, that she spoils him and enables him. And I have a good friend, most of us here have a good friend, Stu, who you know, you look at his life he's 40-something now, he's got to be 47. His mother has been enabling him since he was 9 years old. And he's our local heroin addict, fentanyl addict, dealer, seller. Everybody knows Stu. I love him, and I would love for his mother. I mean, I've been working with her for 9 years to try and stop enabling the boy, but she won't. She won't because she says, "Well, I love him." You can love somebody. And if you're not righteous and fair and just in your decisions, you're just going to ruin that person. You're going to ruin them. When you see a mother in the mall, this is why one of the reasons I don't go to the mall. The other one is I don't know where the mall is. But you see a mother in the mall and she's talking to the kids screaming. Show us, William. The kid's just screaming and screaming. And the mother's going, if you be quiet, if you don't be quiet, I'm going to count to five. And she counts to like 600.
Right.
That mother has just lied to that child. She's teaching the kid to lie because everything I say doesn't mean anything. She's teaching the kid disrespect. And then in the end, the way she shuts the kid up, she says, okay, we'll get the ice cream. And she goes, and she's enabled the child. And this is what she's going to do with that kid all the way through his life. And that's not showing love. That love becomes hatred. You've just ruined that child. And somewhere along the road, that child could even be killed because of your enabling. We got to be serious about it. This is not your usual church congregation. You all know what I'm talking about. We've been dealing with these things. Half of us in here are addicts, or ex-drug addicts, and alcoholics. And you know what I'm talking about. And this is the same with God. God loves us immensely. Like, if you study the Word of God, you can't see anything but the love of God. And part of his loving us is judging us and disciplining us. He says, a father will discipline his children. That's what God says. Just as I discipline my children. He'll discipline us. Why? Because he loves us. Because he loves us. If you had a dad like mine that when you were young, and he'd say, why don't you go play on the 401 for a while? You know? That's not right. So God has just judged the world. He gave them 120 years. Noah's building this big boat, and Noah's preaching to them and saying, listen, guys, this is what God's going to do. 120 years. And they rejected God, and they rejected God, and they rejected. Like, how patient does he have to be? And then finally he says, I can't wait any longer. This has to happen. And the eight people go on the boat with these animals, and everyone else dies. All the animals, all the people, everything, because of corruption and violence in the land. It's not a bad thing. So when we read this story, we see the love of God. We see judgment, but judgment comes through as the love of God. We see the patience of God. 120 years. I wish my dad was that patient with me. 120 years. It's been 2,000 years now. Jesus left here. He says, I'm coming back. I'm going to judge the living and the dead. I'm coming back, and there's going to be judgment. It's been 2,000. He's been patient. 1 Peter says the reason that God is slow in coming back is because he's patient. He wants none to perish. He doesn't want that to happen again. He doesn't want all of us going to hell. He wants us to live with him for eternity. He's given us 2,000 years to make this decision. And look at us. There's going to be like eight of us in the boat. Wow. Great story. I love this story. Fantastic. By the way, if you come from a Roman Catholic background, this is not a myth to teach us something. This is a story that actually happened. And there's not a civilization on earth that hasn't existed that did not record the global flood. Not a civilization on earth. Everybody knows it happened. It's not a myth. And Jesus refers to Noah. And he refers to this whole incident in the New Testament. He refers to it as though it actually happened. He doesn't say, you remember that myth? It's not a myth. The Old Testament is truth. It's to teach us. And Paul says these things were written for us long ago so that we might have instruction. We might know. Otherwise, if this wasn't written, we'd be going, I don't know that God's really going to destroy us all. I think he loves us too much, because that's the way we feel. That's the way we think. God does love us immensely. No one else ever died for you. God died for you. He rose again from the dead, but he died for you. Nobody else ever loved you like that. God's love is immense. But God is righteous and he's just. Now we're going to start. Now we're scared. So the flood is over. Noah builds this ark. He sacrificed. Beautiful story. Beautiful story. I wish it ended like that. I wish it ended like that. What a wonderful story. And then we get the rainbow. God gives a rainbow. This is the first time it's ever rained. When it rained at the flood, that's the first time on earth it rained. All vegetation was fed from the ground. Now it's raining. And it produces a rainbow. And God says, I'm putting the rainbow in the sky to remind you of what's just happened. And to remind you of a promise, I'm going to promise you, I will never again flood the world globally and kill everybody the way I just did. Amen. He says, next time I come, I'm going to destroy the world with fire. He's done the water thing. Now he wants to do the fire thing. So we do have the rainbow to remind us there's not going to be a world flood. So when you see a flood coming, like we'll get local floods. When you see a flood coming, you go, thank goodness this isn't a world flood. But it'll remind you. The rainbow. I was so glad to read this story. When I was about 12, I think. When I was about 12, I read this story. And I thought, well, thank goodness that's what the rainbow is for. My mother always taught me that the rainbow, you follow the rainbow, you go right to the end of the rainbow, and at the end of the rainbow is a little box. And you open up that box, and in that box is a key, and you take that key and you stick it in your belly button, and you turn it, and your bum falls off. Yeah, that's what she told me. You can imagine my relief when I was 12. She was a good woman. So we get to the rainbow part, and we wish that we saw Noah walking off into the distance with a big rainbow, and everything was peachy king. But we don't see that. After he does the sacrifice, first thing he does is plant a vineyard. Plants the vineyard, then of course he's got to sample it all. Has a bit too much to drink. He gets drunk. Then, while he's getting drunk, he gets hot. You know, it's a lot of work working in the garden. So he takes off all his clothes, lays down in his tent, and falls asleep, passes out. This is the story. I think this is what we're reading today. Let me not describe it to you. Let's read it. Genesis chapter something. I can't. My paper there. Oh. Genesis 9, 18 and 28. The sons of Noah who went forth from the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. Now you remember Canaan. When the promised land, when the people, the Hebrews, come across from Egypt, they cross the Red Sea, you know, on the dry land, and God brings them through the wilderness. They come to the promised land. That's Canaan. That's Canaan. That was established by Ham's son, Canaan. Okay, so remember that. These three were the sons of Noah, and from these people of the whole earth were dispersed. So from these three guys, every nation has been dispersed from these three guys. Okay? Noah began to be a man of soil, and he planted a vineyard. He drank of the wine and became drunk, and he laid uncovered in his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father, and he told his two brothers outside. So then Shem and Japheth took a garment, they laid it over their shoulders, and they walked backward to cover the nakedness of their father. Their faces were turned backward, and they did not see their father's nakedness. When Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his youngest son had done to him, he said, "Cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall he be to his brothers." And also he said, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Shem, and let Canaan be his servant. May God enlarge Japheth, and let him dwell in the tents of Shem, and let Canaan be his servant." And after the flood, Noah lived 350 years. Here's this mighty man of God. He's just delivered the whole population of the world on this vessel, all eight of them. And all these animals, he did everything that God told him to do. And at the last chapter, it said he was blameless and he walked with God. He was a man of God. And here he is, builds an altar, thanks God for what he did, and then turns around, gets sloppy drunk, takes off his clothes, lays down in his bed, and passes out. His son Ham walks in, sees his dad naked, walks outside the tent and says, "Hey guys, you won't believe it. Dad got drunk. This mighty man of God got drunk." When we read it in the Hebrew, it's the attitude of him that's all wrong. His attitude is wrong. He's like, ha, 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 ha. The mighty man of God, the hypocrite. And he's telling his brothers, and he's mocking his dad. And those two guys, they're respectful. They just grab a blanket, put it all, walk in backwards, and lay it down on their dad. Weird story. So what do we make of this? How does this story, how can I take this story and apply it to my life? How can I do that? It's crazy. But I see two things, two ways we can apply this to our life. One is that past spiritual successes are no guarantee that we are going to automatically live for the Lord from there on without any watchfulness and diligence on our part. When we do something great for God, we don't just stop there and go, look, that's great. You know, there was this guy at this church we used to go to a long time ago when Jesus first found me. And this guy, every time I heard him talking to people, and he was like old at the time. He's probably, I don't even know if he's around anymore, but he was probably like 400 years old when I knew him. And he'd go around to people and he'd say, he'd give his testimony. Oh, man, he says, you know, in 1955, this is what happened. Look what God did. Look what God did. That was his only story. It's like nothing else happened from 1955 until whenever. That was his story. He was living on that story. God loves me because of that story. And it wasn't even when he got saved. It was just some car incident. And I kept thinking, is that all that ever God ever did for that guy? Because it's pretty chintzy. Like, the story wasn't all that exciting, you know? You ran out of gas, someone came by, happened to have a jerry can. Big deal. Happens all the time. If you have a gas gauge, it doesn't work. So, anyway, the funny thing is, this is what we do. This is what we do. Think about it. If you met someone today and you were going to tell them how God is working in your life, you're going to reflect back on some story that you thought was significant or interesting or fascinating. You're not going to tell them something that happened yesterday. Because for most of us, we don't know that anything really happened yesterday. Because I'm a man of God because 10 years ago, let me tell you what happened. We live on our past successes. That's what we do. When I was in sales for 30 years, they used to tell us, you can't live on your previous year's sales. You know, you had a good year. That's cool. But you can't look back and say, I'm a good salesman because of my last year. You have to look at what you're going to do this year. Otherwise, you won't do anything this year because you'll be living on your past successes. That's what happens. It's the same with our Christian life. You can't live thinking that the Holy Spirit is filling you today because of something that happened 30 years ago. You can't do that. If the Holy Spirit met you 30 years ago and did a miracle in your life, that's fantastic. And from that point on, the Holy Spirit has been doing miracles in your life every day, because if he hasn't, maybe he's not there. Don't tell me what the Lord did for you 600 years ago. Tell me what the Lord did for you today. The Holy Spirit still with you? We can't live on our path. Here's Noah. I just picture this, you know. Well, I don't picture the nude part, but I picture Noah just had this great success. Look what the Lord did. Look how this all came. And God even told him how to make the boat. I didn't even know what a boat was. And the boat floated. And everyone was safe. Everyone was dry. And then it landed on the... And then everything was... And it was a whole new... That is fantastic. What a great story. And Noah thanks the Lord. Thank you, Lord. That was wonderful. And then Noah goes on and lives his life, living on the past success. Oh, I can just relax now. I'm just going to get drunk and lay down on my bed. That's not what we do. We got to be careful with that. This, you see this all through the Word of God. You see that. You see that happening. People relying on a past success. We can't do that. God must always meet us here and now. Not there and then. Here and now. When you're in a place of spiritual ministry, it's easy to live off experiences of the past. A lot, you know, you see a lot of churches, like at one time, you'll hear a story, at one time this church was so vibrant. Oh, the people were worshiping God and things were happening, it was fantastic. And now you're 40 years down the road and the place is dead. What happened? Maybe you don't know who we are. 40 years ago, we ran this town. Oh, God was doing amazing things. He was doing incredible things. People's lives were being changed. Yeah, but what about now? Well, maybe you didn't hear me. 40 years ago, we were fantastic people. Men of God. Women of God. But what happened now? Living in the past. You can't do it. A second thing that we can gain from reading this passage, this story. Some of our biggest defeats occur just after a huge spiritual victory. Oh, the victories. Do you remember the story of Elijah? If you don't know this story, you've got to read it because this is so cool. Elijah, he calls out the prophets of Baal. This is the other big religion at the time. And he says to them, he says, this is all the priests. So there's hundreds of these guys. I can't remember the number. There's hundreds of these priests. And he says to them, he says, your God is a false God. He's a fake God. He's not a God at all. And he says, I'll prove it to you. And he says, look, build an altar. You build an altar to Baal. And then you call down fire from your God. Tell him to light that altar on fire. And so they build this altar and they're marching, they got the wood on it and everything, they're marching around it and they're cutting themselves, they're doing everything they could possibly think to do in order to get their God to light this fire. What a great story, eh? They can't. And the whole time Elijah's mocking them, and it actually says this in the Bible, I'm not kidding you, it says this in the Bible, it says, Elijah says to them, where is your God? Perhaps he can't hear you. Maybe he's on the toilet. He didn't use the word toilet, but I did. But the word is in there. I think it was crapper. Anyway, it's in the Hebrew. William Crapper invented the toilet. I know that, right? Okay, I'm not being rude here. Okay. So when you read the Old Testament, especially in the Hebrew, you see God's got such a sense of humor. It's fantastic. Anyway, so they can't call down fire from their God. So Elijah says, stand back. Let me show you how you do this. And he prays to God. God, here's your moment. God sends down, before he does this, Elijah's showing off. He says, wait, now I'll tell you what. He says, you take buckets of water, gallons and gallons and gallons of water, throw it on that wood. Soak it down. And there's a trench around the altar, and it all filled with water. And the wood was all soggy. Like, it's now this is impossible. And then Elijah says, okay, God, do your thing. God sends down fire from heaven and lights that, it consumes that, the wood's gone, and all the water that's in this big ditch around it is all dried up. You know what happened to those priests? They all killed themselves. They killed themselves. Isn't that interesting? Instead of turning to God, they killed themselves. So here, Elijah's had this huge spiritual victory. Huge spiritual victory. Can you imagine if that was you? And here's this huge, you know what he did right after this? He ran and hid in a cave. Huge spiritual victory. He saw God, the mighty hand of God, casting down fire, lighting that out. He saw all those priests of Baal kill themselves, wiped out. And he goes and hides in a cave. He's suffering from depression that he put himself into because he thought he might be chased after by a queen. Read this story. It's a great story. A big spiritual victory and then a total defeat. Just like Noah. big spiritual victory, and then total defeat. Just like Samson. Samson, he slayed all those Philistine soldiers. Today we call them Palestinians. But he slayed all those Philistine with a jawbone of a donkey. He killed them all. Took on a whole army with a jawbone of a donkey. Because God delivered him. God did that. At this big spiritual victory. And then what happens? Some hot chick comes along. And he gives into the temptation. After he sees God do this mighty thing. Uses him in a mighty way. And then he ends up with a hooker. What a terrible thing. We've seen it with Lot. Abraham's nephew, Lot, he's living in Sodom and Gomorrah. God's going to destroy everybody in Sodom and Gomorrah. He's going to wipe out the whole twin cities. And what he does is he rescues Lot. He rescues Lot from that situation. Lot and his daughters and their husbands, and they take off. They get out of there. The wife didn't make it, but the rest of the family did. And there's this huge spiritual. They look. They're up in the caves and Sodom. You just see the smoke. The place is destroyed. And all of the people were killed because of sin. And then what does Lot do? Gets drunk. You know, hey, let's celebrate. Gets drunk and has sex with his daughters. A huge spiritual victory and then total defeat. And this is the same thing that's going on with Noah. You know what I love about the Bible? Whoever wrote these things, this is Moses writing, but whoever wrote a Bible, all the parts of the Bible, if they were just people like you and I, we wouldn't write bad things about Noah. We'd make him out to be a hero. We would have left out the part about him getting drunk and hanging out naked. Because we don't want these people look like idiots. We want them to look like spiritual giants. But the Bible never does that because it's God writing the Bible. God told these people what to write. They're inspired by God to write these things. And God says, no, you tell the good and the bad. Because otherwise we'd all be going, we can't do this. We can't be like them. They're perfect. They're mighty men of God and I keep falling. I keep sinning. No, they do too. They do too. And it doesn't make it right. It doesn't make it right. It never does. Paul says this, 1 Corinthians 9:27. But I discipline my body and I keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. After Paul says, this is how we should behave. He tries to discipline his body so that he doesn't misbehave, because then it wouldn't make sense. You've got to practice what you preach. It looks like Paul is thinking about people like Noah and Lot and others. Lest having preached to others in the moment of carelessness, I allow something into my life. When God does a wonderful thing in your life, when he does a mighty thing in your life, don't sit back and go, well, I'm a man of God. Did you see that victory? I'm going to celebrate. Don't do that. Don't let your guard down. Amen. Don't let your guard down. We got to be careful with this stuff. Because William has encouraged me to be finished. I'm just going to read to you a final paragraph here. I got more stuff for you, but it is the toilet bowl today, so I'll let you get out a little early. I get to the end of Genesis 9 and I feel discouraged. I look at a godly man like Noah, and I see that even somebody like him failed. It's discouraging. Then I look at the way that most of the human race is going, like Ham and his son Canaan, and I feel, what hope is there? When I get to the end of Genesis 9, I'm ready to look for a person who's perfect. I'm ready to look for a person I can depend on. I'm ready to look for a person who isn't one thing today and another thing tomorrow. I want to look for a person who is yesterday, today, and forever the same. When I get done with the record of God's heroes and I'm finished with that, I want something more. I want to see Jesus. I need someone I could look at as perfect representative of what God intended my life to be like. I need someone who never fails. I need someone who walks with God, goes through storms, and comes out triumphant and resurrected. I need a perfect man. I need God who reveals himself in the form of flesh to show me not only what I need as a human being or what I need to be as a human being, but also what I need to be as a child of God. I need Jesus. Noah's not enough. Samson's not enough. Lot's not enough. I need Jesus. And all of these people, all of these heroes that have a moment with God and then they fall, just like us. We don't follow them. Great story. Shows us how God acts. But we don't look and follow the man. We follow God. We look for Jesus Christ in all of this. He never fails. He never lets us down. When he has victories, he doesn't go out and become a loser. He doesn't sin. We need Jesus Christ as our example, as our representative. The Bible says that we all have sinned. Every one of us in this room are sinners. I'm a sinner, you're a sinner, we're all sinners. We can't save ourselves. I could die for you, but that would do no good because I'm full of sin too. I can't take your sin away. So God doesn't want you to perish. He doesn't want anyone to perish. So God comes to earth and becomes a man just like us. Takes on human form. Takes on a human brain. He sets aside all of his powers, his all-knowing, his all-powerful, his all-presence. He sets that all aside and he says, I'm just like you, 100% human. Oh, I'm still 100% God because I can pick all that up again. That's mine. I never got rid of it. I just put it aside. I'm 100% human like you, but I'm perfect. God is perfect. He's without sin. And so God says, I come down to earth, I become a child, I grow up like a man, just like you, tempted in every way. God was tempted in every way that we are. And yet he never sinned.
Hallelujah.
And he remained sinless so he could die for us, so he could take our sin from us and put it on himself. That's beautiful. You want to talk about love? That's love. What God? If you were God of the universe, the creator of all things, would you ever think, I should go down and become a puny human like them just so I could die for them? That's incredible love. Jesus died on the cross, took away our sin, took away our guilt, and then 3 days later he rose again from the dead to show us that he is God. He is God. In order to receive what Christ did on the cross, we have to believe in what he is, what he says he is. We have to believe he's God. We have to believe the work he did was good. It was good enough. It was sufficient. Again, I'm sorry, if you come from a Roman Catholic background, I just want to make this clear to you. If you come from a Roman Catholic background, you have absolutely no assurance that you're going to ever be in heaven. You don't. Because when you die, you have to go to purgatory and you have to pay for this. Your mortal sins, the sins you committed in the flesh, you have to pay for those. Christ paid for your venial sins on the cross, but he didn't pay for your mortal sins. That's a lie from hell.
Yes.
When Jesus died on the cross, he died on the cross to take away all my sin. Amen. It says all my sin in the Bible. It doesn't say part of my sin. Mm. They're calling Jesus a liar, and that's a terrible, terrible thing.
Yes.
Jesus wants to free you from all sin.
Amen.
He wants to give you eternal life. That's incredible. Without Jesus' death on the cross, we can't have eternal life because the wages of sin is death. Close your eyes. Everybody close your eyes. Think about this. Think about this. Maybe you're one of those people that have been rejecting Jesus Christ. Maybe you've been rejecting Jesus Christ all your life. Well, Jesus is calling out to you. He's been running after you. He's been chasing you. He wants you to have eternal life. God is not mean. He's not cruel. He's not full of hatred. He wants all of us to come to repentance, to turn to him. That's what he wants. And he's made it possible. All we need to do is confess that we're sinners. We need to be able to say, I'm a sinner. If you can't say that, you have too much pride. And pride's going to make you go to hell. Because without telling Jesus that you're a sinner, without confessing that you're a sinner, you can't be saved. The second thing he wants us to do is ask for forgiveness. We didn't sin against anybody but God. We sinned against God, we need his forgiveness. The Bible says if we confess our sin to God, if we confess that we're a sinner and we want forgiveness, God is faithful and just. He will forgive our sin and he'll cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I'm a sinner, I can't save myself. God, forgive me for my sin. And the third thing is, I will follow you.
Yes.
I want to be your disciple. I want to follow you. I want to learn from you. If God's talking to you right now, the Holy Spirit is talking to you, he's nudging you, he's going like, this is you, man, you need to do this, you need to do this. Think about it, it's eternal life. You do those three things. Those are just conditions. They're not paying. You're not paying for eternity. You cannot pay for eternity. Jesus paid for you. But he's offering this to you free. Eternal life is a free gift of God through Jesus Christ. But he says there's these three things. These are conditions. If you're here today and God's talking to you, you want to give your life to Jesus Christ. I'm going to give you this opportunity because the Lord has. If you get up and come forward, I just want to pray with you. You don't have to do anything else. But by you getting up out of your seat and walking forward, you're saying this. You're saying, I know that I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. I want God to forgive me for my sin. And I want to follow Jesus Christ. And if that's you, get up out of your seat and come forward. Just let me pray with you. You don't have to give us money. You don't have to join a club. All you got to do is just walk to the front and then walk out of here. If that's you, God bless you, girl. Oh, yeah, everybody stand. Make it easier for them to come forward. Pamela? Okay, come here, young lady. Pam's going to pray with you. Look at this. Jeff, this young man here. There you go. Anybody else here know they need Jesus Christ? Come forward now. Don't put this off. Don't put this off. Jesus wants to save you. He wants to give you eternal life. He wants to give you peace, love, and joy through Jesus Christ. God's talking to you. Don't put it off. Come forward. Come forward.
Can I come again?
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. There's no limit to how many times you can give your life to Jesus Christ. That's great.
Hallelujah.
Gary, come pray with my brother here, Paul. Okay, here you go. Gary's going to pray with you, Paul. Yeah? Amen. Warren, why don't you come pray with Paul, too? You know him. Okay. God bless you, brother. God bless you. Oh, everybody pray. Father, we thank you so much for these lives. We thank you for what you're doing in them right now. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon them. God, may they know what is happening right now. May they feel that the burdens are lifted. Their sin is gone. They're made perfect in Christ Jesus. Brand new creations in Christ Jesus. Work in their hearts, work in their lives. Surround them with people that can encourage them in their walks with you. Oh, God, bless them, we pray. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, praise you. Praise your name forever. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, God. Work in these lives. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise you. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, marvelous, wonderful, infinite grace. God pours out his grace. He gives us what we don't deserve. And he doesn't give us what we do deserve. That's mercy. What a wonderful thing. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Today we have our communion. These little cups here. Okay? Y'all can work on opening them if you want. We'll do this together. We'll participate together. We can open them. Watch out, they're a little tricky. By the way, I have some great news. Not only is Jesus coming again, but we're getting new cups. They have crackers instead of these things here, these styrofoam. Yeah. I'm just so thrilled. Oh, yeah? Yeah. The reason we do this, I don't know what background you come from, but this is the Thanksgiving, the Eucharist, the Lord's Supper, the Lord's Table, whatever it is you call it in the background that you come from. We do this together, and this white thing doesn't become the body of Christ. It does not become the body of Christ. This is a symbol. This is a symbol. It's to remind us of the body of Christ. This is just juice. And it's to remind us of the blood of Jesus. It does not become the blood of Jesus. There is in no way are we participating in cannibalism here today. I want you to know. And Jesus said on the night before he was to be killed, he was sitting having dinner with his disciples, and he said to them, he said, listen, as often as you guys eat together, do this. And when you eat the bread, you remember my body that was given up for you. Remember my body that was given up for you. And when you drink the juice, remember my blood that was poured out for you. And do this as often as you can together. You don't have to do this at church, by the way. You know, when you're at home having dinner with your kids, it's not a bad practice to say, you know what, before we eat, we're just going to remember what Christ did for us. Okay? You don't have to be a pastor to do that. Okay, so let's participate together and remember what Christ has done for us on the cross. Everybody, thank him. Thank you, Jesus. Marvelous Savior. Wonderful Lord. Worthy is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We thank you and we praise you. We honor you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's sing together, Good and Gracious King. Thank you. just thank you for this morning. Thank you for this time together, Lord God. Thank you for your word, Lord Jesus. Thank you for your mercy and your grace, Lord God, for doing everything to save us, Lord Jesus. Thank you for those who put their trust in you this morning. I pray you would encourage them, Lord God, in your love and in your grace. And Jesus, we just pray that you would bless our time of fellowship downstairs. Thank you, Jesus, for one another. Lord, help our conversation to be uplifting to one another, that we would encourage each other. And God, we just thank you for the love you've put in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Hope to see you all tonight. Have a great afternoon.